Started. We don't want to punish those of you who are here bright and early on a Saturday morning. So the good thing about this is you're going to get a very personalized experience. We can ask as many questions as we want and have some engaged learning here. So that will be kind of nice. So my name is Michelle Demaray, and I'm a faculty member at Northern Illinois University. And the title of our symposium today is New Frontiers in Bullying of Youth with Disabilities, Research, Social Policy, Law, and Practice. I have a really easy role here. I'm just going to kind of introduce the topic to us, and then I'm going to introduce our panelists, and then I'm going to turn it over so that we can hear from each of the panelists. So, of course, we're here because one of the things we know is that children with disabilities and wide-ranging disabilities, so physical, developmental, intellectual, emotional, sensory, et cetera, are at an increased risk of bullying, of being bullied, and also at an increased risk of maybe perpetrating in that bullying dynamic as well. And so with that increased risk, our focus today, obviously, is really delving into this and talking about this phenomenon in kids with disabilities. If we look at prevalence, and I know some of the other speakers are going to speak more to actual prevalence rates, but children with disabilities are bullied at about 2 to 3 times higher rates than kids without disabilities. So clearly, we know that that's a problem, and want to talk about addressing that. And that's what this panel is about today, is some of that, how do we address this problem? So I wanted to put this in context a little bit as we think about risk factors for youth who are bullied, because our focus today is on youth with disabilities, but that's really just one risk factor that may play a role in that bullying dynamic. So I wanted to kind of step back and make sure we think broadly about all the things that may put kids at risk. So individual characteristics can put kids at risk, and actually our focus on students with disabilities is an individual characteristic that can influence higher risk levels of bullying, but that also there's other individual characteristics such as youth that are LGBTQ, and actually some of our presentations will be talking about individual characteristics. Things like social skills would be another individual characteristic that might contribute to that involvement in bullying. Also peer groups, so delinquency, peer norms and that kind of thing also can put kids at risk for engaging in bullying. Family characteristics, we're not going to actually talk about a lot of those today, but is another important piece in that. Supervision, parent-child relationships also contributes to whether kids are at risk. And then school and classroom characteristics. And that can be really broad, such as school climate. We are going to talk some about classroom characteristics and social dynamics in the classroom as well today, so that's something else that we're going to be looking at. But I just kind of wanted to put that all into perspective for us today. So we're talking about mostly focused on youth with disabilities, but that is just really one of many things that can contribute to putting kids at risk of engaging in the bullying dynamic. So what can we do? So when we think about what we can do, and we pulled this proposal together, was really, and that's a little bit hard to read, I don't have my glasses on, but research, thinking about research is important really to further understand. Not a lot of research has been done in the area of bullying of youth with disabilities. So research to really help us understand the phenomenon, and then to research interventions. What can we do to solve this problem? So I feel like that research piece is really key and really drives the other areas. It really drives, it could drive social policy, school policy, law, and also the practice, which is a big piece there of what we can do in schools to reduce bullying of youth with disabilities. So today we're going to have presentations that cover all of these areas. We're going to have some presentations that cover research. We're going to have some social policy and law. And we're going to talk some about practice as well in the schools. So with that, I'm going to introduce our different the topics we're going to have. First, Dr. Chad Rose is going to be presenting. He's from the University of Missouri. I'm actually part of this team down here, too, with Christine and Julia. I'm not going to be presenting with them. But we met Dr. Rose. We went to the Alberti Center for Bullying Prevention, Bullying Abuse Prevention, last year, where there was a conference on bullying of youth with disabilities, which is sort of how this symposium arose, was out of some of those ideas that we got from that conference and collaboration ideas. So He's going to be talking about reducing bullying involvement through social skills development for youth with disabilities. So Chad does a lot of research on bullying of youth with disabilities. But again, I feel like this could really be an applied piece as well, because he does really applied research looking at how we can intervene in some of those individual characteristics for kids, like social skills. So Chad's going to be doing that. Then we are going to have Dr. Mitchell Yell from the University of South Carolina. He's going to be focusing on the law. So again, what we know is that it's a little more complex when we think about kids with disabilities, because bullying of kids with disabilities could violate federal, state laws, be involved with harassment. And so he's going to be giving us some guidance on all of that. I was just telling him, I saw on the news yesterday that a family is suing a school because their child committed suicide and was cyberbullied. That's been really in the news a lot lately. So that's always something that schools are struggling with, is sort of school policies and those legal risks. So, and I always find it very complicated. So I'm glad that he's here. When I talk about the law and bullying, I'm always quite overwhelmed. And then Dr. Tom Farmer from the College of William and Mary is going to be talking to us, and he's going to be talking about managing social dynamics to reduce students with disabilities' bullying involvement. So he's really looking at the classroom and the teacher, and I liked, when I was looking through his slides, one of his terms was person in context, so really looking at kids in the context of that classroom and using, you know, the teacher in that classroom to focus on how can we reduce bullying in school. So I'm excited to hear that presentation. And then we're going to end. This is Christine Malecki and Dr. Julia Ogg are sort of the group I'm part of, but I'm not going to be presenting with them, from Northern Illinois University. We have a federal grant that is used to train school psychologists to better prevent and address bullying in schools. So they're going to be talking about training as thinking about that applied practice, what can we do? And so that focuses really on better training people in the schools to deal with bullying. So they're going to be talking about that grant and what's going on with that grant and some of the outcome data with that as well. So because we thought there was going to be hundreds of you here, we were encouraged to be sort of technologically advanced. We wanted to see if people would tweet questions out to us. If you would like to tweet us a question, you're welcome to tweet us a question. It might almost be easier, since there are five of you, to raise your hand, and we're happy to answer that question. But but this is a hashtag, so if you want to tweet, you can write it down. I do have Starbucks gift cards for people who tweet, so Garrett, you probably need some Starbucks later today. Oh, okay. Yeah, it's a little hard to do if you don't have Twitter. So this is the hashtag that... if you do tweet, and maybe we'll switch the gift cards for people who raise their hand and ask questions, and reinforce people for asking some questions. So that'll be our. And I did tell the panel they couldn't win the Starbucks gift cards. So, and I have five of them. So your odds are looking really good. So with that, though, I want to move on, and I'm going to turn it over to Dr. Chad Rose.
Hello, everyone. Y'all hear me? Well, I'm being videotaped, so I'm going to try to keep myself under control here. It's 8 o'clock in the morning. I'm happy to be here. I've had a long week of travel, so this is the only thing standing between me and getting home to my family, so you're going to get everything I got left. I am excited to be talking about this topic because this is something that I've transitioned into recently. I spent most of my early career focusing on kind of the predictive and protective factors associated with bullying involvement among youth with disabilities. We've recently moved into looking at interventions and really taken to heart some of the recommendations that the National Academy of Science, Engineering, and Medicine made regarding multi-component programs. And so today I'm going to talk to you about why we do what we do and how we're moving forward with some of the multi-component programs that we're doing in schools. I am currently an associate professor in the Department of Special Education at the University of Missouri. I'm starting my fifth year there. And I also recently formally developed the Mizzou Ed Bully Prevention Lab. And our lab's designed to do three things. One is impact policy to help schools be in compliance with state regulations, but also make sure that they are writing substantive policies that impact students. We do teacher training, and I think the most important thing we do is we have several schools that were we've implemented interventions. So when we think about defining bullying, I'm not going to spend a lot of time on definitional issues because we've struggled with that in the field for a number of years, so much so that the AERA task force has argued that as researchers, we rarely subscribe to this definition anyway. But really, when we talk about the definition, we usually talk about intentionality, repetition, and power imbalance. Dan Oveis in the early 2000s introduced this idea of unequal levels of effect. And I use it since I'm a disabilities researcher because I tend to work with students who have low social and communication skills, and sometimes they can't quite understand why they are being victimized. And so it leaves this unequal levels of effect with them because they have a lack of understanding, where oftentimes their low social skills ends up being part of the reason why they're being aggressed against. And so the perpetrator does a lot of victim blaming. And so I keep that in my definition when I talk about students with disabilities. If you look at the most recent data from the U.S. Department of Education, the headlines read a couple of months ago, significant decreases in bullying for the first time in a decade. And I'm like, yes, I can do something else. I can study mathematics instruction or something. Then I look at it, and we're still at 1 in 5. I mean, that's a lot. We're still at 1 in 5. So I probably would encourage them to reframe that headline. But I mean, we're still at 1 in 5 students are reporting victimization based on the national data that we have available. And there are limitations to the national data, and we can get into that if you want. But this is 1 in 5 students in general. But if we think about students with disabilities, they're 2 to 3 times more likely to be involved, both as perpetrators and victims. So if we took that 13% of the population out of this study, our population would be much more like 1 in 2 and 1 in 3. And that's incredibly alarming to me. And we used to think about bullying as this linear process, to where we had pure bullies and pure victims, and you can see it play out in schools as true bullies and these kids that were true victims. Well, we no longer believe that. That's something that studies have demonstrated is an inaccurate portrayal of student behavior. It looks more like this. Kids move in and out of roles based on time and context. And I can get into a lot of that with you, but I mean, ultimately, students are victimized within a given context, and students engage in perpetration within a given context. And so sometimes when we talk about students with disabilities, for example, sometimes they are entrenched in academic areas or academic programs that place them in more restrictive settings. So when we think about the reciprocity between bullying and victimization, sometimes these students are bullying and victimizing one another, right, within this restrictive environment. When they leave that environment, then they go out into, let's say, a more inclusive environment, they may themselves be victimized. And so it really depends on the context where they are. My slide got all messed up. So we subscribe to the social ecological framework, and I'm not going to get too deep into this because we can have, I mean, I gave like a 2-hour lecture on this the other day. So, but ultimately we believe that kids develop and learn and become involved in bullying based on the complex social systems that surround that individual. And these behaviors change and are reinforced over time. So we learn a lot of our behaviors from our family. So like I have a 7-year-old and she has a fully developed personality. Like, I mean, you can see that she is my daughter. If you meet her, you could tell, trust me. But one thing that we we say here is sometimes with some of our more subjective disabilities, disability identification may also be part of a student's lack of integration into these social systems. So I worked with students with emotional behavior disorders when I was teaching, and I would bet that somewhere along the lines, their behaviors deviated from that of their normed peer group, and that's how they were identified with a disability. By the time they got to me in high school, as long as we had behavior plans in place, they didn't engage in challenging behavior. I would think that a lot of my students were misdiagnosed because they were having troubles navigating the interaction of some of these social systems. Now, I don't pretend to be a PBIS guy. I don't pretend to speak the PBIS language all the time, but I do appreciate the tiered structure of PBIS and the framework by which we can implement bully-specific interventions and skill-based interventions that reduce bullying involvement among youth. And so I like to use the framework within this multi-tiered system to talk about our interventions. And I believe that schools currently have enough information and the ability to implement interventions within these tiers that would impact bullying as they currently stand. However, some things that we can do are more specific to bullying, and I think part of the problem that we have related to our current commercial programs, our bully prevention programs. They teach awareness, they teach you how to define bullying, and they teach you how to report, but they don't necessarily teach you what to do. They don't necessarily teach you lifelong skills. And so that's kind of our tact. Essentially, we believe that if we increase social and communication skills, we will decrease bullying involvement. Early in our work, we found that a lot of the research on bullying in students with disabilities were saying that that social and communication skill deficits were what was leading them to be more involved in bullying. And so that's kind of where we are now, is we're saying, look, and I'm a very simple thinker. I am surrounded by a lot more smart people than I, but I think we can do this very simple thing, right? We can teach skills, we can decrease bullying. I mean, it's simple enough for me. So we use social-emotional learning as the vehicle by which this happens. So self-awareness, social awareness, responsible decision-making, self-management and relationship skills. If we teach these skills, kids are less likely going to be involved in bullying. We've demonstrated it in several of our manuscripts. Dr. Espelage has demonstrated it in many of her manuscripts. And I think it applies to students with disabilities. But when we approach it from a multi-tiered framework, what we have to do is really look to see how these interventions are being situated within this tier and how students and schools are making decisions. So the way we do this is we encourage all schools to do a school-wide climate survey. Schools have to have data in order to make decisions. It doesn't make any sense to implement an intervention without having data. And so we help facilitate the development of the climate survey, and we help facilitate the implementation. Then we encourage schools to take a social-emotional learning approach, an approach to where we really are including these five components. On top, this would be for all students. On top of that, what we do is we encourage schools to do what's called a behavioral screener, but we're screening for social and communication skill deficits. And we do that here. Those students who are identified for that then are provided with targeted social skills instruction. And then we'll talk about what future directions we'll be heading here in a few minutes. But really what we're saying is we survey everyone. We get the sense of what's happening. We provide some sort of school-wide intervention that's grounded in skill development, not grounded in increasing awareness, okay? Grounded in skill development. And then what we do is we do a screener to identify kids that could use targeted instruction. And so our approach to our social skills targeted instruction really falls within these 10 domains. We do it for middle school, which will be some of the data that I'm presenting right now. We do the social skills improvement system, a modified version. And I did modify this because I found that some of the material was not necessarily age appropriate for middle schoolers. And I also found that some of the videos were not all that culturally sensitive. And so I did make some a number of modifications over the past 2 years, but we stuck with these 10 social skills. And so each week we go in and we do social skills instruction for students who are targeted in that targeted group. This is kind of the breakdown of what the schools look like when we initially started this study. And it's what we would expect. 80% of our student population didn't qualify. They weren't identified with having low social and communication skills. 20% did, and then you run into the research problem. Only 5% of those consented. So we had 5% of the total population consented. We are starting to get more now. This was really just a pilot, and so we're starting to get more now, and we'll have more information in the future. But when you look at this, you can see that a lot of our students were involved in bullying, victimization, and then any construct that's related to that. But what we did was we looked at high involvement, right? So 10.2% of our student population suggested that they were involved in bullying or engaged in bullying, one standard deviation above the total mean. And the yellow here are those students that did report or affirm at least one item on our scale. And the reason I show that is because I show it for many reasons, but one is to talk about how some of the bullying statistics can be inflated to where if we really just took this, we could say, you know, 60% of our population engaged in bullying behavior. That's not my agenda. And so I tend to look at those students who are highly involved. And so from a qualitative standpoint, from a qualitative perspective, we interviewed our students, our middle school students, after they got done with the 10 weeks of instruction, and they had fantastic things to say. So I don't usually talk about qualitative data, but I thought it was interesting that they were kind of talking about the same things we were talking about. They were talking about they were more self-aware. They had better conversation skills. They were able to participate in groups a little bit better. And so I was impressed with that. And these are, trust me, when we walked in, you could tell many of these students needed social skills instruction. So these are the data that we have from based on a matched peer group. So we took the students that were involved in our groups and then compared them to a randomly selected student in the same school, the same grade, and the same gender, and the same racial or ethnic background. Okay, and what you can see is the dotted lines represent the matched peer group. The solid lines represent those students that were involved in our groups. And even without looking at bullying and victimization, only identifying kids based on social and communication skills, you can see that in each case, our students were reporting higher levels of whatever we were looking at. Victimization, cyber victimization, relational victimization, bullying, fighting, and relational perpetration. And so that's just identifying kids on low social skills. And I think that that's interesting in and of itself. But when we look at these data, we're starting to see downward trends in all of our markers. Victimization, cyber victimization, relational victimization, fighting, and relational perpetration. We're starting to see a downward trend after 1 year. We're going to go back and look at 2 years of data. So I don't want to make too many conclusions based on this because the downward trend is quite narrow. But I do think it's promising. One thing that we did see an uptick in was actual bully perpetration, but you see a sharper decrease in fighting. So some students were likely probably renegotiating the behaviors that they were reporting, and also some students were probably more aware of what bullying was by this time, and so they were reporting that they were engaging in more of those behaviors. And so when we look at the second year of data, I'd anticipate this would be a different path. But right now we're extremely excited that we're seeing downward trends in our targeted groups. The main thing here and the main message that I have, and I think I'm probably going over my time and I apologize, but the main message that I have is disability status doesn't necessarily serve as the sole predictor. No longer in this field can we start to and continue to identify and say students with disabilities are more at risk without considering intersectionality without considering that disability is more than a label. Disability is related to the disability severity, where they're receiving services. We have to consider gender. We have to consider the amount of services that they're receiving. And so all of these things play a role. And so in our work previously, we've been really siloed. I'm hoping that we can start to branch out more and start to look at severity and labels and how all of these things interact. But with that, you can follow me on Twitter. You can go to my Facebook page. You can do all that stuff. I got all of it up there. So if you have any questions, I think we'll take them at the end because I'm probably over. So thank you.
Huh? You're not
over. So. Oh, I'm not?
So
the question is, in the climate survey, do the students or parents report the disability? This is an interesting question. Early in my career, when I was working with Dr. Espelage, we used to have students report and self-identify. And in those early papers, if I would have known now, we would have called it a perceived disability. But then we've moved past that. And so what we do is we have districts provide the disability data as they are as they're reported on their IEPs. And so the way we do that is the districts own the data. I work with the districts. They own the data. And what we do from that end is we take and have the districts create a number. They sometimes use student numbers, but they essentially create a unique identifier that I don't know. And they give me a file with the data, and they give me a file with demographics based on that unique identifier. And so I'm unable to it's de-identified. And so that way we have true data as reported to the state on disability identification. Any other questions? Yes. Yeah. And you know, it's interesting. This has been a big debate in Missouri as of late, because the law that they used to use for assault, the assault charges that they used to use in juvenile cases in our schools, they dropped the highest degree of misdemeanor. And so what they did was it became a felony. And so now what's happening is some of our schools are starting to panic because the laws that were enforced in our schools, they can no longer use that charge, and they're afraid that students are going to be charged with felony assault. But I don't want to get this confused. When we talk about, I'm not pro-criminalization of youth, and I also believe that sometimes when kids engage in behaviors, those behaviors, if they're considered criminal, I don't necessarily believe that they should be considered bullying, right? I mean, if you can get arrested for it at the mall, you know, it's a criminal behavior. I think we have to do a better job in supporting our youth, but we do in fact have a law that prohibits this type of behavior in schools. And we have a state law. We have a state law for bullying, but we also have this criminal code law that just changed to where our state is still trying to figure out how to negotiate this new criminal code and how it applies to bullying. But all the headlines when it came out was, you know, new criminal actions for bullies. So, I mean, absolutely not. I mean, unfortunately, we have an unfunded mandate, and the law was just signed. Our new bully prevention law goes into effect this year, and what they require schools to do, they have a 2-day, 2-day, 10-day rule, meaning that schools. Teachers have 2 days to make a formal report. Principals have 2 days to start an investigation. The school has 10 days to close that investigation. All schools have to have interventions in place. All schools have to train any adult that works in the building, and all schools have to train all their students, among other things. But it's an unfunded mandate. So with unfunded mandate also comes, you know, fewer dollars, but also less oversight. So I don't know who's going to hold schools accountable for making sure that they have policy and intervention in place when, you know, we have a lot of rural schools to where, you know, how are they going to get access to training? How do they get access to intervention? How do they get access to all this information? I mean, they have limited access and opportunities, yet they're still going to have to hold true to the law. We'll see how it plays out. Oh, yeah. Well, when I worked in Texas, they launched their new law as I moved to Texas. And part of what happened was they had heavy reporting requirements. And schools didn't want parents to make formal reports. I probably should watch what I'm saying. I'm on video, but I mean, it's the truth that schools had a difficult time when people would make formal reports because of all of the red tape that followed after that report and what they had to do. I mean, it was really out of control. I hope that they've since changed it. I don't know, but you know, schools are reluctant to make reports. If they do have a heavy reporting requirement, I don't think our state really has that level of accountability to report to state departments. I believe that each school district has to report at the end of each quarter or at the end of each semester. They have to report, make an incident report. But short of that, they don't have to report every single thing to the state department. I don't think our state department has the capacity to deal with that either. Do I have a copy of it? I have a copy of it. I mean, we use already validated scales. So we use the University of Illinois aggression scales to measure bullying, victimization, fighting, and anger. And I've been studying this for 11 years now, and I've used that in every one of my studies. So, essentially what I do is something I didn't talk about is I go meet with superintendents of school districts before we launch anything, and I have a conversation with them about what they want to measure. So looking at their individual needs, I know what I need to measure in terms of bullying, and I need to measure some of these other constructs, and they're usually in agreement. But then I also can tailor it to them to where, for example, one school district wanted me to measure resiliency. I've never measured resilience before, but we found I went back to the literature, found a scale that was validated, and was able to report these measures of resiliency for their students. So the data that I collect are for the schools, but then I have a data sharing agreement that they allow me to look at it. So what we do is we try to include similar measures across each district, but then if a district wants caring, you know, we can do caring or, you know, school belongingness. I mean, we always include that, but if they really wanted that, we could include more measures. So that's how we approach it. But yeah, I mean, I have a copy of it, of the base, I guess the base model, if you will. Yes. Yeah, that was actually our first paper in 2009, and I was presenting on that. And I was presenting that paper at SRCD, I think, and Dan Oveis was sitting in the audience, and it was nerve-wracking. But I've been doing this now for 11 years since, and that was our first paper. And the reason I bring up Dan is because he asked a question that we still can't answer. He asked whether or not increased rates of bullying and victimization was related to the severity of the disability or whether it was related to class placement. So as the severity of disability increases, we tend to increase the restrictiveness of placement. And so we still can't answer that question directly. We do know that in some cases, for example, in one of our recent studies, we know that students with emotional behavior disorders and kids with intellectual disabilities tend to report higher rates of bullying and victimization in more restrictive settings, where kids with learning disabilities and kids with autism tend to report higher levels of victimization in inclusive settings. And so you have to take that with some level of understanding that a lot of our kids with learning disabilities are pushed into inclusive settings, so we didn't have a lot in restrictive settings. But also we have to think about the reciprocity between bullying and victimization in these restrictive settings. I don't necessarily believe that kids with intellectual disabilities are leaving their restrictive setting and going out and bullying someone without a disability. I just don't believe that that's happening. I actually don't believe that they meet the definition of what a bully would be, and that's for a different day. But I believe that what's happening in these environments is they're bullying and victimizing one another, and they're reporting that it's happening, but I've never been a huge proponent of restrictive environments anyway. I think that we can provide services in a more inclusive environment. And when we have, so when we think about the students with autism, and we're not the only ones to report that students with autism are getting victimized more in inclusive settings. Catherine Bradshaw's work and their group has reported this as well. I think that level of victimization, it's part of the disability, yes, but I believe that it's grounded in their social skills and social communication skill deficits. So that's why we take the approach that we take and try to increase those skills instead of teaching awareness and teaching where to report bullying. But we do see differences in class placement, but we also see differences in disability labels themselves. We also see differences when those disabilities and class placements interact. And so that's why we start to look at this idea of intersectionality. The idea that not one single predictor will serve as the strongest predictor out of all of them, meaning that we have to consider the severity of the disability, we have to consider where the services are being provided, we have to consider what type of services they are, we have to consider what the disability is itself, we have to consider demographic factors, gender, race, religion, sexual orientation, all of these things. Dorothy and I were talking a long time ago, and we started thinking about this idea of dual minority stress. But the more I think about it, it's essentially multi-minority stress. I mean, it's once you start checking all those boxes, then these kids, the more boxes checked, the more at risk a student is. Here's this thing. This doesn't make any. I'm supposed to be. I'm sorry for not restating the questions. Okay. So, here's the thing. It doesn't make any sense to me at all to take a student with emotional behavior disorder, place that student in a restrictive setting with a group of other students with emotional behavior disorders and expect them to come out better on the other side. That doesn't make any sense. I've been very outspoken about that for a very long time. I don't believe that we have any data to support that students are really receiving the functional skills necessary to move into a more inclusive environment after they've been placed in a restrictive environment with other kids that are engaging in aggressive behavior. I mean, we know behavioral modeling. I mean, we've studied behavioral modeling for decades, but yet we continue to do it in our schools. It doesn't make any sense to me. And I mean, I've been pretty darn outspoken about that. Because I believe that kids should be educated among their same age peer group. And I believe that most of the services that we provide, with the exception of a few, most of the services that we provide to those kids with really high incidence disabilities can be provided in a general education environment. I don't see why they can't. I mean, I taught in a self-contained environment. I taught students with emotional behavior disorders. I taught students who engaged in violent and aggressive behaviors. To me, I could have provided those same services that I was in a restrictive setting, provided them in a general education environment, and the outcomes would have been the same, other than the fact they would have been able to see other peer models engage in more socially appropriate behaviors. But, you know, I don't get to make those decisions, I guess, for schools, but I really push them in the direction of more inclusive environments.
Late and didn't realize we have rewards for people who are asking questions. So I'm going to come pass out some rewards.
I figured that out after I like. Okay, let's scoot right up here. My name is Mitchell. I'm from the University of South Carolina, and what I'm going to be talking about for the next 20 minutes is the law, policy, guidance, and bullying with students with disabilities. And essentially, I'm going to address primarily how the U.S. Department of Education has provided guidance to the schools and to school administrators in how you need to be, how they need to be applying the law. And Chad has already talked about the fact that students with disabilities are much more likely to be bullied than their non-disabled peers. Additionally, it's important to understand that bullying affects a student's ability to learn. Bullying students with disabilities may be a violation of state laws. It may be a violation of Section 504 of the Rehabilitation Act and the Individuals with Disabilities Education Act, which I'll be talking a little bit more about in a minute, and that school personnel must recognize, investigate, and respond to incidences of disabilities. Now, also, as of March 2015, all 50 states had passed laws regarding bullying, so it's very important that you understand laws in your state. Two websites that you can access your state's individual laws are bullypolice.org and stopbullying.gov, and what they do is that you can look on these sites, find your state, and click the link, and it'll go to the section on bullying in your state law. And they vary quite a bit from very minimal sorts of laws to quite intense laws that require a lot of school district personnel. And also, the White House had a summit on bullying in 2010, and the U.S. Department of Education developed this website, the www.stopbullying.gov, which they described as their one-stop comprehensive site for resources on bullying and bullying prevention. Now, Dr. Arnie Duncan spoke at that time the Secretary of the Office of Education spoke at the summit. One of the things he mentioned is an reinvigorated Office of Civil Rights in the U.S. Department of Education would be investigating complaints of bullying and harassment vigorously. So in essence, what he was saying is that bullying is a violation of federal civil rights laws. And that of the civil rights laws, three that we are concerned with primarily are Section 504 of the Rehabilitation Act of 1973, the Americans with Disabilities Act, or the ADA. These laws prohibit discrimination on the basis of disability. Title VI of the Civil Rights Act of 1964 prohibits discrimination on the basis of race, color, or national origin. And Title IX of the Education Amendments of 1972 prohibits discrimination on the basis of sex. Now, this is Section 504, the Rehabilitation Act. It's not a part of Section 504. This is Section 504. It's one paragraph long and says, no otherwise qualified individual with a disability in the United States shall solely by reason of his or her disability be excluded from participation in, be denied the benefits of, or be subjected to discrimination under any program or activity receiving federal financial assistance. Now, if you looked at Title VI of the Civil Rights Act of 64, the language is virtually identical with the exception of, What the Civil Rights Act essentially does of 1964 is it substitutes disability in the United States, so shall solely by reason of his or her disability, it substitutes race, color, or national origin, and the rest of the law is exactly the same. It's the same with the Education Amendments, or Title IX of the Education Amendments of 1972. It just says shall solely by reason of sex be excluded from. So these civil rights laws essentially do the same thing. They prohibit discrimination against a certain class of individuals. And with respect to bullying or violations may occur when peer harassment or bullying is based on race, color, national origin, sex, or disability, and if that is sufficiently serious to create what is called a hostile environment, and such harassment isn't addressed in the schools, it's either encouraged, tolerated, or not adequately addressed, or completely ignored by school employees, that would be discrimination under Section 504. And courts have said that discrimination under 504 would be or Title VI or Title IX have four elements. That is, the student has a disability, the student is harassed based on the disability, the harassment is serious, sufficiently severe, or pervasive enough that it alters the student's educational environment or creates an abusive environment, and the LEA, or local educational agency, is deliberately indifferent to the harassment. Now, as I'll talk about in a minute, when we're talking about violations of in accordance with the Office of Civil Rights, that's much broader. This definition becomes much broader. Therefore, the requirements that schools adhere to these civil rights laws is actually broader than the federal law itself. Now, in terms of Section 504, the Office of Civil Rights, also called OCR, is the agency within the U.S. Department of Education that's charged with the enforcement of the anti-discrimination provisions of Section 504 and Title II of the ADA. Now, in the Department of Education, the Office of Special Education Programs, or OSEP, is the agency within the U.S. Department of Education that's charged with the administrative enforcement of IDEA. And I'll talk about that a little bit more in a minute, but in addition to being a violation of federal law, bullying may also be a violation of federal civil rights laws, I should say. Bullying may also be a violation of the Federal Individuals with Disabilities Education Act. Now, OCR, the Office of Civil Rights, and OSEP, the Office of Special Ed Programs, have issued policy guidance. And that is, what they essentially do is they write letters that are open public letters, usually addressed to superintendents of public schools, or they're sent to superintendents of public schools and published, and they're called oftentimes Dear Colleague letters, because they begin with the phrase, Dear Colleague. These DCLs have been issued a number of times by the U.S. Department of Education regarding the issue of bullying. They've issued, I believe it's five now, DCLs regarding bullying, which essentially means the U.S. Department of Education is very concerned about bullying occurring in public schools and are very prescriptive, not as much as New York, but quite prescriptive about how school district administrators, teachers, related service providers, psychologists address the issues of bullying. And I'm going to talk specifically about four DCLs or five DCLs, Dear Colleague letters, that have been issued and what OCR and what OSEP has been telling us that we as school district personnel have to do. And the first is, the first Dear Colleague letter was written by the OCR, the Office of Civil Rights, and the Office of Special Ed Programs in 2000. And they were beginning to really take notice of this bullying problem and felt it was very necessary to issue guidance, policy guidance, to school district personnel on how they should handle bullying. And first off, in this DCL, they said school districts officials must take immediate steps to effectively address bullying when it occurs, and take steps to prevent it from occurring. And that, in fact, what they need to do is take school district-wide actions, such as developing anti-bullying policies on a school district level, conducting professional development with administrators, with teachers, with psychologists, related service providers on bullying, regarding the problem of bullying, identifying, and this professional development should help school district personnel understand the warning signs of bullying, and furthermore, how to report bullying in ways that get the school district acting to prohibit and establish grievance procedures. And that is the DCL, or where you can find it. And actually, if you just put in Google DCL, Dear Colleague Letter and Bullying, you will get access to all these. Now, in 2000, this was the first written policy guidance provided to school district personnel. It was developed both by OCR and OSEP. Now, in 2010, a second DCL was issued, which means essentially the U.S. Department still considered this to be a pretty serious problem. And one of the things they did, they actually did five things. This was a letter just by the Office of Civil Rights. And what the Office of Civil Rights said is that they, as an entity, are not only responsible for enforcing Section 504, prohibition against prohibiting discrimination against students with bullying, but they are also the entity responsible for enforcing Title VI in schools, that is, prohibiting discriminatory actions based on race, color, or national origin, and Title IX of the Education Amendment. So OCR in the Department of Education is implicated, or has to enforce all of these different procedures. Second, they said, is that these procedures not only involve preschool, elementary school, secondary school, but they involve post-secondary education. So if bullying is occurring against any of these populations in a post-secondary setting, technical school, community college, university, that is also a violation of federal law. Additionally, OCR said you have to know your state laws. It's very important because bullying is a discriminatory act violating federal civil rights laws, but it also can be impacted by state laws. Fourth, they said the biggest issue anytime there's discrimination based on harassment or disability has to do with discriminating and essentially with creating a hostile environment that we as school district personnel must remediate. And fifth, and this is very important, it said essentially that school district personnel may be in violation of laws if they know or should have known about bullying. That is, and I'll talk more about that in a few minutes. In 2013, another Dear Colleague letter was issued, and I believe this is the first time that I know of that the Department of Education has been so concerned that they keep issuing these policy guidance statements. I want to go back to this for a second. This was specific information or guidance they provided to school district personnel. When you know or should have known that bullying is occurring, number one, separate the accused harasser and the target. Number two, provide counseling for the target and harasser. Three, take disciplinary action against the harasser. Four, provide training or other interventions, not only for the perpetrators, but for the larger school community. And five, take steps to further harassment and prevent any retaliation against a person. In 2013, they essentially repeated what they had in previous Dear Colleague letters, but they also said this: whether or not bullying is based on a student's disability, if the bullying deprives a student of educational benefit, it deprives a student of what is called a free, appropriate public education, which is a violation of another federal law, which I'll talk about in a second, the Individuals with Disabilities Education Act. And in that case, when bullying occurs, school officials must investigate and respond to incidences of bullying, and IEP teams should further address it. And then finally, in 2014, OCR came out with another Dear Colleague letter that even put another wrinkle into this whole issue of discrimination. And they said, bullying a student with a disability on any basis, whether or not it's on the basis of the child's disability, could result in the denial of FAPE under 504 must be remedied. and addressed by a Section 504 team or an IEP team. Now, they also said OCR often investigates schools. So if parents see bullying occurring in a school, they can file a complaint with the U.S. Department of Education, the Office of Civil Rights, and if OCR believes there's reason, they will investigate the complaint. And what they do is, according to this DCL, they said, our investigators are going to be looking for these four elements. If they come into school investigate bullying, they will look at, number one, did the bullying occur? Two, was the bullying sufficiently severe, pervasive, or persistent so as to create a hostile educational environment? Three, did the hostile environment interfere with or limit a student's opportunity to participate? And four, did school personnel know or should they reasonably have known about the bullying, but they did not act to prevent and address the bullying? If those conditions are present, OCR will find a violation of Section 504. So that is essentially how a bullying of students with disabilities or bullying based on race, color, or national origin, or based on sex can be a violation of federal civil rights laws. Now, bullying can also be a violation of the Individuals with Disabilities Education Act. And I've already talked about this, so I'm not going to be talking about a lot, but IDEA requires that an eligible student with disabilities who is receiving services under the IDEA must receive a free, appropriate public education. If bullying of a student with disabilities interferes or deprives them of educational benefit in some way, that failure by itself constitutes or could constitute a denial of free, appropriate public education and be a violation of the IDEA. And there's basically two elements. Did the school personnel know or should they have known that the effects of bullying may have affected the student's free appropriate public education under either IDEA or Section 504? Did the school district personnel fail to meet their ongoing obligation to ensure FAPE? If so, a violation has occurred. Now, the question is, in both of these instances, when do school personnel know? And both of these DCLs say that a school is responsible for addressing harassment incidents about which it knows or reasonably should have known. So if there was some suspicion that bullying was occurring, they need to investigate and address. They have further said that harassment bullying may be in plain sight, it may be widespread, wide known, or it may be not as obvious. But in either situation, if the school is aware of the misconduct, they need to trigger an investigation of the incidents. And it must be immediate. It must be appropriate to investigate all instances. And also, the school, must have well-publicized policies. Now, I'm going to skip over the legal standard because we've already talked about this. But when we think of these two laws, there's a basic checklist we need to follow regarding bullying and harassment procedures. One of the things we need in the schools is specific procedures for reporting and resolving complaints that are widely published and provide for school districts to undertake prompt and equitable investigation. And these harassment procedures must have descriptions of who and how and to whom complaints are made, a description of the investigation process, a description of how findings will be reported to parents, and the prompt and effective steps that are taken. Number one is to prevent bullying by creating a school environment that's sensitive to disability harassment or bullying and educate staff, students, and parents about what bullying is, and then furthermore, to widely publicize these policies, provide consistent and up-to-date training of staff, and to address bullying. That means to investigate, to interview, to document, to address bullies. If students are participating in bullying, there must be consequences put in place according to the DCLs to address the bullying, but that isn't enough. Furthermore, there has to be steps taken to educate the bully, a bullier, and proactive means must be taken to address the needs of the victims. We as school district personnel need to implement monitoring programs to follow up and systematically assess and modify our bullying presence, our bullying programs. So in conclusions, what these policy guidance statements are saying is that bullying of students with disabilities, of students or in race, color, national origin, or sex, may be a violation of Section 504, Title 6 of the Civil Rights Act, or Title 9 of the Education Amendments of 72. Bullying with students with disabilities may be a violation of another federal law, the Individuals with Disabilities Education Act. And when school personnel have knowledge that a student with disabilities may be being bullied, school personnel must conduct an investigation. Parents must be notified immediately, and school personnel must take immediate and effective action to stop the bullying and ensure it does not recur. So that is 21 minutes, so it's a little bit over. Do you want me to take questions now if there's any, or just move on? Maybe we should move on.
Maybe we'll move on because I'm worried about
okay.
Make sure everyone can get through, and then we'll save questions for
them. Okay. Okay. It's interesting following Mitch and following Chad and these two messages that are coming together. Chad's really talking about the idea of how do we work with the characteristics of the student and work with their social skills. And Mitch is talking about the environment, the policies, the laws, how do we create school settings that really provide supports for students with disabilities. And I myself, like Chad, I was a special ed teacher for several years for students with emotional behavioral disorders. And as I was doing this work, I was actually also getting a master's in special ed at the University of North Carolina at Chapel Hill. And I had the opportunity to work with two different sets of people. Over at Duke, John Cooey was studying social skills and peer rejection and that sort of thing. And then Bob Cairns was studying at the University of North Carolina, was studying peer group processes and how those contributed to aggression and those sorts of things. So my point is the idea of bringing together the individual and the context is what my talk is going to be about today. The idea of classroom social dynamics, I don't know if you're familiar with Deb Pepler's work that she did back in the late 80s, early 90s, where they were looking at what's happening on school playgrounds. And they actually had kids with video recorders at each end of the playground, and they had kids who were carrying backpacks that were mic'd. And basically what they were finding is they were watching kids involved in bullying that you know, it's not just a dynamic that occurs between two individuals, but rather it's the social community. It's how students play together. It's how teachers organize the activities that students are engaged in and so on, so that when we think about bullying, we can think about it as being something between a victim and a perpetrator, but that we actually have to situate it within the context of the social community. So that we need to understand the social risk for bullying involvement that Chad went through, but we also need to understand how the teacher has an opportunity to actually, in some ways, manage that social environment. And so I'll be talking about the concept of the invisible hand. And then I'm going to be talking about what I call the scouting report approach. It's an approach that my colleagues and I have been funded by the Institute for Education Sciences for about 15 or 20 years now to do research primarily in middle schools, but also in elementary schools, of looking at social dynamics and how can we manage those social dynamics to help teachers better engage students more productively in the classrooms. And in that work, we've developed what we call a scouting report. So I'll be talking with you about that. So first, with regards to the idea of the classroom as a society, that what I have here is thinking about here in the middle that bullying reflects the overall social dynamics in the classroom. That thinking about a student, they are in the classroom with sets of skills, but that the overall classroom itself is organized in ways that impact each individual's social behavior. So the idea up here at the top, social synchrony, that as kids interact with each other, they interact in ways that elicit and reinforce the behaviors of each other, that their behaviors are synchronized. This is very close, if you're familiar with the work of Yuri Bronfenbrenner, his social ecological theory, and so on, that Yuri, back in the 1940s, his dissertation was on classroom social networks. So the idea of peer networks here is really building from the idea that kids are embedded in peer groups, and peer groups within the classroom are actually, there's typically 4 to 6 peer groups in a classroom. Oftentimes, those classrooms, the peer groups, are hierarchically organized so that you'll get a social structure where some peer groups are more influential and more dominant than others. And then within the peer group itself, some students are more dominant and other kids have much lower status. And so that when we think about bullying, we have to think about how students are situated in that context and how the behaviors that they're engaged in really are, in many respects, reflecting the dynamics of students actually in some ways trying to enhance their status and position in the social hierarchy, or actually trying to protect against losing status in the hierarchy. So within this, you'll also get peer culture and norms. Some classrooms, you can have norms where that kids are very pro-social in their thinking, and the kids who are really popular and have high status and influential are the kids who are academically engaged and others, you know, that the classroom itself is really supportive of pro-social behavior. Other classrooms, the whole idea of things like mean girls and social aggression, that kids will actually use social aggression and bullying as a way to enhance their own status and to put others down. And so that whole idea of peer group inclusion and exclusion, trying to be in the group of popular kids, trying to make sure that kids who aren't popular aren't in your group, and that sort of thing is part of what goes into the bullying dynamic. And so the idea that as teachers are managing a classroom, being aware and able to actually manage that social system, the peer group structure, how kids relate to each other, and what's associated with popularity is one aspect of what we think needs to be a focus for bullying prevention. So you have that whole idea of the classroom social dynamics, but then again, thinking at the individual level, going back to Chad of thinking about the social skills, but realizing each kid is in a peer network and so on. And so that who kids affiliate with, whom, whether or not they're perceived as popular or perceived as being unpopular, and those sorts of things are important. What we find is that bullies, and you know, Chad was saying that there really aren't any pure bullies or pure victims and that sort of thing. And yes and no, the point that Chad was making is that it is contextualized. And so when you're trying to think within the context, you really have to understand what are the characteristics, what's the social role of students. What we find is bullies, kids who aren't victimized by others but who just bully, are typically kids who are well connected socially. They're perceived to be popular. Other kids think that, you know, this kid's dominant. I might not like them, but I want them to like me, because if they don't like me, I'm in trouble. that type of thing. And so we find the kids that are bullies typically affiliate with other kids who are popular. They typically are, they're aggressive, but they're not bullied by others, that they don't be victimized. However, they do have to be careful about protecting their status. So from that perspective, they can be the target of other kids. Kids who are victims, just pure victims, those kids are most likely to, they're most likely to either not be in a peer group, or if they're in a peer group, they affiliate with other kids who actually have low status as well. So they're kids who can't protect them if they are being bullied. So what you'll often find is that if a kid is victimized, that they're either isolated and don't have any peers who will stand up and support them, or they're affiliating with other peers who actually themselves are victimized. And then bully victims. Bully victims tend to be kids who are rejected, that other kids really, really don't like them. They'll be aggressive. They'll respond back to kids who bully with attempts to victimize as well. So that these are kids that, very much to Chad's point, tend to not have social skills or have social skill deficits, and so that when others are victimizing against them, that they respond in ways that aren't effective. These students also have a bit higher rates of being rejected, but they tend to affiliate with other kids who themselves, that they may actually victimize each other. So they can be in a peer group with peers who actually are aggressive and have problems where they actually reciprocally are synchronized in ways that they support each other's victimization of themselves or others outside their group. And then the non-involved typically are kids who are productively engaged in the classroom and that sort of thing. So with regards to students with disabilities, what we find is that about 20% of students with disabilities actually are not in peer groups. Now, that means not necessarily that they're identified as being rejected. Rejected is different from being socially isolated. Socially isolated is coming from a measure of, do you hang around with any kids? Whereas social rejection is typically a measure of how much someone's liked by others. And kids can be socially isolated, but could still be liked or not necessarily disliked, or kids could be very disliked, but still actually be in a peer group. And it's important to understand that. But 30 to 50% of students with disabilities affiliate with peers who support their difficulties in terms of being involved in bullying and victimization. So that the question isn't, do they have friends and associates, but it's actually a question of, do these friends and associates contribute to their involvement in bullying? 50% or more have status and reputation problems. So 50% of students with disabilities are either rejected or neglected in terms of sociometric status, and they're perceived as being, as having social reputations that aren't favorable. So they're viewed as kids who get in trouble, who have problems, who seek help, who aren't fun to be around, and things like that. So they have social reputations that put them at higher risk. Their social behaviors are negatively synchronized with peers. So the whole idea of how I respond to someone elicits a response back from them that actually makes it more likely they're going to bully me. And they develop social roles that support their bullying involvement, so that who they affiliate with, where they are in the social hierarchy, actually contributes to the likelihood that peers view them as a target for bullying. And it's not an issue that folks are saying, I want to get this person because they're a lower status, but it's because of this dynamic of kids jockeying for position in the social structure that you actually have all these different interactions and this pursuit for social roles going on. And that what I find is that when you look at the literature, that basically students with disabilities are more likely to be victims or bully victims, but they're not more likely to be the pure bullies. Because students with disabilities tend, as I think Chad's work is telling us, they tend not to have those social skills that pure bullies typically have. The pure bullies often are very good at manipulating others and work in ways where they use their social skills against others. And so they're not more likely to be bullies. Okay, implications for intervention: that intervene at the level of the context as well as intervening at the level of the students. So the work that Chad's talking about with regards to social skills, it's very important, but it's important to the degree that we also have to understand that if you're training students with disabilities in terms of social skills, you may be able to change those skills, but if they're out interacting with peers who in some way elicit their problem behavior and they're in peer groups that are reinforcing their problem behaviors and they have a social role, then you know the work of Shelley Hemel of talking about the idea of there's a reputational bias that once a kid has a certain reputation, that the others in the peer group may be responding to that reputation and not the particular skills that the student is displaying. So if you change their skills, but they already have a problematic reputation, then you need to work with that reputation and their position in the context as well. So that means, in my opinion, that we, when we're doing bullying prevention and intervention work, we really need to focus on the person in context, both the skills and characteristics of the student and the overall context. So supporting person in context interventions, teacher attunement to classroom social networks. We can teach teachers to know what are the peer groups, who hangs around with whom. We can teach teachers to be aware of who are the popular kids. Are they popular and pro-social, or are they popular and aggressive? Who are the kids who are isolated and don't hang around with any other kids? And that when we teach teachers to do this, we can teach them to be an invisible hand. The term invisible hand is a term that Uri Broffenbrenner, Bob Cairns, and myself, we were talking about the social dynamics in the classroom. And the idea, you know, Bob was saying that teachers can make lots of decisions that we as researchers don't pay attention to throughout the school day that really impact students' social opportunities and impact how students view each other. And there's a lot of work right now. I know that I think it's Margot Hendricks is doing work, Jan Hughes is doing work on how teachers relate to specific students and how that sends messages to the rest of the class about that student. So that the idea that if I think the teacher likes a student, that may make me more likely to like the student, or if I see the teacher struggling with that student, that may actually make that a student that I'm more likely to engage in negative ways that result in bullying and victimization. So the point is of helping teachers understand the dynamics and understanding how they actually contribute to the classroom social culture and social system. And so we created what we call the scouting report, where you go in and you look at what's happening in the classroom and you try to figure out, are there things that the teacher's doing? Are there certain people here in the context who are leaders or who are isolated or whatever, who are interacting in certain ways that are impacting this particular student's social opportunities and their relationships that's contributing to bullying? So the idea of teaching teachers to be attuned to social dynamics, reducing aggression and creating a greater sense of school bonding. These are all things that we've found that when you teach teachers to manage social dynamics, that they can actually be better attuned to students' placement in the peer structure. And when they are better attuned, it reduces aggression, It creates a greater sense of school bonding in students. There's a positive perception of the school ecology, greater peer acceptance and reduction in dislike and victimization, more positive peer group associations for aggressive youth, greater perceptions of peer protection from victimization, and positive peer cultures for academic effort and achievement. What we find is the students with disabilities, when they're in classrooms where teachers are well attuned and are purposefully managing these dynamics, that they'll say that my classmates are less likely to support each other in bullying against me. And so in conclusion, the point here is that classrooms can be managed not simply in terms of managing behavior, but in managing the social relationships and opportunities of students, managing how they experience the social system. And if we're trying to impact bullying, we need to realize that it's the individual and it's that social system. So if we can enhance teachers' attunement, and if, as Chad is saying, we can go in and do social skills training and those sorts of things, working at the individual level, and then mapping that on to what are the dynamics that are occurring in the classroom, then we can really have a focus on the person in context, and we can deal with leverage points that are particular for that specific student. So that's my 20 minutes. I have references, if anyone's interested in the literature that supports what we were talking about. And there's my T.W. Farmer at William & Mary. Thank you.
Good morning. I'm Christine Malecki from Northern Illinois University, and happy to be here. We, Julia Ogg and I, are going to be talking about a project that the three of us, Michelle Demaray, Julia, and myself, are involved in at NIU. We were hearing about the research around bullying involving students with disabilities, the law, more research, thinking about that social context, and we just spent an hour and a half learning about this one topic and one particular risk factor, and that's the tip of the iceberg, right? Well, what we found is that the training around bullying in general, let alone bullying and thinking about students with disabilities as a specific population, is really lacking in our training programs. So a study in 2010 found that 70% of school psychologists rated the quality of their anti-bullying training as poor or fair. Only basically 30% said it was good or excellent. So I think what happens is that we get a broader context of training around supporting positive behavior, positive school climates, intervening with problematic behavior, that kind of thing, social skills training. We're getting all of the elements, but our trainees that are future school psychologists maybe don't always put it into context or think about, that aren't thinking, I know what to do in terms of preventing or addressing bullying in schools. So again, in another study, 75% of school psychologists said that they got their training around bullying from other sources other than their graduate training. So we also collected some data regionally, and this was in Illinois. About 112 school psychologists responded to an online survey that we conducted. And, 54% said they had no or little training related to bullying. And 75% said that they had no or little training in their graduate training program. So we saw a need, and we took us 3 years and 4 submissions to obtain a U.S. Department of Education, Office of Special Education Programs, personnel preparation grant focused on preventing and addressing bullying in schools. So we were awarded this grant in 2015 and have been doing this work, first a pilot year, and then last year was our first full launch, and we're going to talk a little bit about that. So how we can take all of this continuing research, this building knowledge base in the basic understanding of bullying and also the practice, and put it into our training programs. So this is our project, PPAB, Project Prevent and Address Bullying for Students with Disabilities, a Multi-Tier Behavior Approach. We have 13 scholars so far, but we have 5 new scholars joining us in the fall, so that number will continue to grow. I think by the time our project is over, we'll have 23 uniquely trained scholars who will have expertise in preventing and addressing bullying in schools. Our goals are to improve the quality and increase the number of specially trained licensed school psychologists with this unique and specialized training, and to improve the developmental outcomes of students with disabilities by decreasing the prevalence of bullying. We have 5 components as part of this training grant. We have a seminar that is all year long, so it's a fall and spring continuous seminar that our scholars are involved in. We have a partner school where there's a practicum component that our scholars are involved in, expert consultation, professional development, and that's both providing professional development and having our scholars provide professional development as part of their training, as well as consuming professional development, and dissemination. So Julia and I are going to spend a few minutes and go through each of these elements to tell you a little bit more about it.
Good morning. I'm going to talk a little bit about the seminar, which is the didactic and content heavy portion of our training program. And then I'm also going to talk about our partner school collaboration. And those are really intertwined, so I'll kind of go between both. So as Christine mentioned, we have developed this 1-year course that our students take, specifically learning about bullying. And so in a moment, I'm going to show some of the specific kind of breakdown of the sub areas of that course. But these are kind of the big picture. So we talk about defining bullying, theoretical perspectives of bullying, and the foundations and kind of some of the main outcomes of bullying. So students get a sense of not only how the construct is defined, but also what the problem is in terms of what happens if we don't intervene. Then we're going to talk about some specific risk factors. So we focus on, of course, students with disabilities, but some other groups like LGBT youth and what we know about prevalence of bullying, but then also outcomes again. And then we kind of in the second semester, we make a shift into really thinking about now having this base knowledge about bullying and applying it. How do we assess bullying in schools? And then how do we intervene with youth across the tiers? So in a moment, I'll show you like some example. I apologize in advance, the font is really small, but I put it on there so you could see some of the readings that we have that relate to the different areas, and you can have that if you pull up the slides after the presentation. So part of it is this kind of didactic. We're talking about these content areas, the students are doing readings, but really the other half of the course is really meant to be applied and thinking about how to use these skills in practice. And so we accomplish that in a couple of ways. One is through our own dissemination efforts. We have the students try to take what they're learning and translate it into practice. So how could we boil down maybe some definitions or what we know about specific groups, and how could we put that into a handout for parents or for teachers. So that's a lot of what we're doing with the website resources, and we're going to continue that over the next few years. We've also, as Christine mentioned, been involved in doing some professional development in our community, and so that's something that we involve the students in doing. It's not just us going out and doing it. It's having the students prepare the materials, think about how they would teach information to teachers or to administrators. And then a really, really big part of the applied portion is our collaboration with our partner school. And I'll talk a little bit more about that in a minute. But in terms of the seminar, we typically spend 2 hours in the didactic discussion portion. And then we take the last hour and we do supervision around some of the applied activities, which usually pertain to the data collection we're doing with our schools and the intervention planning that we're doing there. So when I get to the engaging with the partner schools, I'll touch more on that. Okay, so the next section just has each of those content areas, definitions of bullying, theoretical frameworks, characteristics of kids who bully and are victims, and outcomes. And these are just a sample of some of the readings we'd have students do. So you see some of the names of our panelists are up here, but really trying to get them into this literature that they might not otherwise get in other courses. Again, just examples. So at-risk groups, there's readings here pertaining to youth with disabilities, LGBT youth, and also how bullying relates to race and ethnicity. Those are kind of the three major areas that we've focused on in the class in terms of at-risk groups. Next, we talk about issues and assessment of bullying. So we really start to get the students knowledgeable about the different assessment tools that are out there. As I think a lot of the panelists have touched on, it's a complicated issue in terms of assessing and thinking about defining bullying. So getting students kind of aware of those issues so that when they maybe want to use a tool in their class, they can, or in their schools, I'm sorry, they can kind of have some good knowledge of what might be the best fit. We also talk about legal and ethical issues, and have the Dear Colleague letters, which were mentioned today, but just having students, again, get a sense of what are some of the important points that they can share with their schools. This is an area that a lot of schools are really, really interested in. And I don't know if we mentioned, all of our trainees are specialist-level students, so they are going to be practitioners in schools, so it's really important that they have this information. And then this is the intervention slide, which I put it all in one, so again, I don't expect you to be able to read each one right now, but we focus on putting the interventions in context in terms of tiers of service delivery. So at tier one, we focus a lot on development of what Dr. Rose talked about of lifelong skills. So we talk a lot about social-emotional learning. Our students right now are learning the second step and CHAMPS program so that they have some good kind of tier one strategies. As part of that, we do also look at the bullying specific programs and the research on those so they can kind of have some ideas of what the outcomes compare across those different types of interventions. We talk about tier two and tier three interventions, so strategies and targeted interventions for kids who intervene. And then we kind of move to thinking about, so it's helpful to know that, you know, school climate and some of the broader issues are really important from a preventative standpoint, but teachers also often want to know, like, what can I do right when bullying happens, or what are some strategies as a student you might be able to use? So we also try to kind of approach the intervention piece from that angle. What are some interventions or strategies you can kind of use right on the spot? Because it's, I think it's helpful to have kind of both sets of knowledge. So that just gives you an example of what the course covers. In terms of some of the outcome data we've collected so far, we have a control group, which is another graduate level program. Okay. Let's see. I guess we don't want to update. Yeah. Sorry. Can I just close that? Okay, there we go. And so we had some good outcomes in terms of knowledge gained on our knowledge test between our group and the post and the control group. In terms of the partner school consultation, we have kind of three broad goals that we've been kind of evolving and developing as we go. But one is we are committed to helping them assess their bullying behaviors at least once a year, so we have a chance to kind of dig in and see what things look like in their context. We also, in doing that, do a lot of consultation with the team there, which is the school principal, or has traditionally been the school principal, the guidance counselor, and then a key teacher that they've selected to be part of the team. So we work with them a lot to think about these data. What do we want to do in terms of next steps? How could this be integrated in things that they already have going on? And then really where we are now is kind of shifting to, now that we know what some of the concerns are, what are some of the things we could do to address those? So I'm going to talk briefly about those. This just gives you some ideas of the demographics. It's a pretty big middle school, majority low income, a little bit of a higher number for number of students with disabilities,
a lot of students are not ready in terms of some of the broader assessment data for going on to the next level academically, and pretty diverse in terms of student race and ethnicity. Okay, so some of the things that we've done so far is we've collected data with the staff and students both in the fall and the spring. And I'll give you an example of some of those results in a moment. Our scholars also collected behavioral observations during lunch periods because we have identified those through our surveys as being a really difficult time for the school. And then we've also done some focus groups with the students to hear a little bit more about what their experiences are. And then, as I mentioned before, we're engaging in regular consultation meetings. So the survey, I'm not, obviously can't go over all the results. We were prepared like a 50-page report for the school. So there's a lot of data points in there. But some of the ones I wanted to touch on, this is just an overview of what's covered. So types of bullying, specific, some of the types of risk factors we talked about, where bullying occurs, who do students tell, how do they feel about that. So this is one of our items, which is related to students with disabilities specifically. So some kids call other kids' names or use phrases like retard or that's retarded or similar items. So we asked the students to report how frequently that occurred in the context of a friend, somebody they didn't know well, somebody they didn't like. And what you see is it's not a particularly, you know, it's not happening all the time, but it's something that's happening, and it's happening a fair amount. I think we thought it was interesting that students were most likely to say that kind of comment to either a friend or someone they didn't like. So it was viewed as maybe the playful kinds of teasing or maybe more of an insult to others. This one's really interesting. So bully location, where have you been harassed, and I'll just point out that, so 67% of kids said they hadn't been bullied, but so of those who had, the most common two places were in the hallways or in the lunchroom. So those kind of unstructured settings were ones where they were running into that the most frequently. Responses to bullying, 62, so only about two-thirds of students told someone about it. They're most likely to tell their parents or friends, less likely to tell a teacher or an adult, which, you know, isn't exactly what we wanted to hear. And then the other, this one kind of stuck out to me, students' perceptions of teachers' response. Only 25% reported that teachers did something when they, or regularly did something when they saw a student being bullied. So what we've taken to, where we kind of went with that quantitative data is we said, let's take a look at the lunchroom and kind of get a sense of what's going on. And one thing we found is that when we observed, I don't know how many of you have been in a middle school lunchroom recently, but it's not someplace I would probably want to spend a lot of time. It's really loud. There was not a lot of clear rules, so the students kind of weren't sure when they were supposed to go get their lunch. There was also, like, they could earn recess, but it wasn't totally clear about, like, what they had to do exactly to earn recess. And it seemed like the main disciplinary or the main kind of behavior management strategy was yelling in response to misbehavior. So this really kind of stuck out. The other thing that we noticed and when our scholars observed is that it was a really long lunch period. So the students were in the, they could eat their lunch in about one third of the time that the lunch period was. So there was a lot of time for them to kind of get in trouble after that. And this was consistent with observations from school staff. We also did these focus group, which kind of confirmed some of the thoughts that bullying occurs a lot when the teachers aren't around, in less structured settings. Students perceive the teachers don't really necessarily know what to do. Some teachers help, but not all of them. Kids said they wanted to learn, like, what to do, how do they handle when they get into a conflict with their friends instead of using physical altercations, which was a pretty common response to being bullied that they reported. So what we've done with this information and with our scholars is we're working on consulting around some changes to the lunchroom. So one of the big ones is just splitting it in half so that there is two lunch periods, and so each one is a little bit shorter, and then they will have a structured activity for the other part. We're working a lot on the kind of the tier one strategies. We felt like when we saw that there was a lack of some of those management strategies, that may make more sense to really focus there. So we're bringing in safe and civil schools right at the start of the next school year. And the scholars are going to work on training the lunchroom monitors on some positive behavior strategies. And then we're also starting to get into thinking about some how to address the concern of the students wanted to learn, have more kind of social skills and know what to do to address bullying. So that gives you an idea of kind of some of the components of our training program. Our outcome data has been pretty positive, and we certainly will have more of that as the program progresses.
Okay. The last two components are, well, the first I'll talk about is expert consultation. So Dr. Dorothy Espelage came and spent some time with us, and she's our primary expert consultant. She was here earlier this morning. She came out the first year and spent time in our community, spent time with our scholars, spent time with us, helped us, looked through the syllabus that we were developing and highlighting, here's some additional readings or up and coming things that you need to be aware of. So that expert consultation, I think, is really key so that we are ensuring that we continue to stay, be giving our scholars the most up-to-date knowledge as it comes along. So this is actually, it's a really difficult to see picture here. It was from far away in a big auditorium. That's Dorothy Espelage at a community event. So we launched when she came last fall and actually invited the entire community, parents, community members to our campus for a free event where she gave a talk about translating research on bullying into practice. Then she came out to our partner school, and this was still summer, so school had not started. It was about a week before all of the activities, so all of the teachers that did come were there voluntarily, and it was a really fruitful discussion. And it's kind of interesting. This was our personnel preparation grant. This is our training grant. But one of the things she did was really kind of build us up and build up, this is a big deal that you are a partner school and working with this university. This is really an amazing opportunity. And that, just that launching of having some outside person say, hey, this is a big deal, has kind of helped to make this school feel really important, as they should. And they are, as Julia said, I mean, we have made so much progress with them, and they are such a team that is open to seeing where the challenges are and wants to knock down barriers. And it's been amazing. And I think our launch event was a big part of that. We also have brought in Dr. Amanda Nickerson for an event. And this was a university research-based event. So it was a research brown bag that she presented to our colleagues in the psychology department. So when we bring our experts in, this is Dorothy with all of our scholars at the time, we really are trying to make the best use of them in terms of reaching out potentially to the community, to giving us feedback as project directors to make sure we're up to date, and also reaching our scholars as well. And then professional development is another piece. Julia talked about that. We build that into the seminar. Our students actually providing professional development. Last year, our scholars presented to about 50 regional educators at an event at NIU, and they will be doing that annually. That's a picture of that event. There was even a satellite school district that joined us. The three scholars at that time, they ran the entire thing. I was never once at the podium. So it's really great training, part of training them to learn how to prevent and address bullying in schools. For them as school psychologists will be professional development, and so they're getting that practice. And we get great ratings. The participants really enjoy learning from our scholars. Dissemination, Julia mentioned, we're creating a website of resources, and we're again letting the scholars use some of that time in the seminar for that and to be able to get our feedback. We have a bunch of resources ready to go, so watch that website. We're just putting final touches on things. They've been working hard all summer. This is at our state conference. Our scholars presenting a poster about the project. That is that poster. And we actually took the presentation that the scholars had helped develop and presented that at our state conference as well. So we're trying to make the most for all of the hard work that's going into this training to be able to get it out as widely as possible. This is a screenshot of our website so far. So our outcomes for our dissemination are still to be determined. Next summer, we'll be having our advisory board on the grant, review our website resources and review our website to give us feedback. And other than the positive feedbacks at conferences, we will look for other ways to measure our outcomes. So in conclusion, we learned that we need more explicit training. We are using an integrated and multi-method training approach. And what we're learning kind of anecdotally, at least from our scholars, is that it is this practicum component and the knowledge building through the seminar, the hands-on practicum component, the professional development, all of those things intertwined are what we think is making this a more impactful training experience. And that's what we have for you.
So we used every minute of our time. So what I'm going to do, just to be polite, because I know there's another group presenting next, is if people have questions, maybe we'll stay up here for a while and you can come up and ask questions and talk to people. Is that okay? Because we're right at our time limit. So we'll be up here if anyone has any questions. So thank you for coming. Thank you.